Okay, welcome everyone to the Center for Marxist Education for part of the ongoing Red History lecture series. Today we'll be doing the heroic deed on myth and revolution, where I will loosely be dealing with Jose Carlos Mariategui, among other people. I didn't have enough on Mariategui by himself, since most of his works are not translated, but there's some good stuff there. Before I start, I'll give you the schedule as I understand it for the next few months. This is also for the people watching at home or on your iPad. Nikos Palantis, who will be a Eurocommunist for next month. Daniel Benside, a French Trotskyist for December. Probably not even pronouncing the next one right. Amadeo Bordiga, who would be a left communist for January. And Walter Benjamin for the Frankfurt School for February. Beyond that, I haven't planned. The last two still need to be revised, which will take time. So when I do this, I give my own particular examples, which draw on research I've done. If someone else was writing this, they would probably not give as many examples from French history. Okay, I will, just because those are my interests. So you could probably substitute your own. So we'll start. This should take maybe about 40 minutes. So again, the heroic deed, myth and revolution. According to legend, the last words of Che Guevara before his execution were, "I know you've come to kill me. Shoot, coward, you are only going to kill a man." What Che meant here was that the cause of revolution would live on despite his death. Whether or not the myth is true, the meaning behind it has inspired revolutionaries throughout the world. In certain ways, the myth surrounding Che Guevara has been just as important as the truth. In fact, myths provide a crucial underpinning to how ideology and society is able to function. Myths play a major role not only in society, but in radical political movements, as was recognized by the French syndicalist Georges Sorel and the Peruvian communist Jose Carlos Mariategui. And despite the scientific pretensions of much of the left, myths also supply inspiration, passion, and faith to militants in the course of struggle. Now, before discussing the role of myth on the left, we need to have some idea of how myth works in the world. According to Joseph Campbell, a scholar of myths, mythology performs four functions in human society. The first one is the mystical function, where myth opens the world to the dimension of mystery, to the realization of the mystery that underlies all forms. The universe is full of wonder, glory, and mystery that we lie in awe before. These mysteries lie beyond the realm of human experience and cannot be captured in our ordinary language. Yet the symbols and rituals of mythology are a way to address and make sense of this reality that lie beyond our comprehension. The second function of myth, Campbell says, is cosmological. Myth in this sense can be thought of as a form of proto-science, showcasing how the universe works by providing explanations for the creation of the world, the origin of human life, the change of seasons, etc. However, in modern society, the cosmological function is taken over more and more by science. However, Campbell states that myths and science don't come into conflict. Rather, science pushes us to the edge of mystery, to that which can never be known, such as the source of life. Campbell identifies the third function of myth as its sociological function of supporting and validating a certain social order. This purpose of the myth can vary greatly depending upon the particular society. We can actually expect feudal society to consider usury and the pursuit of profit to be vices, while capitalist society would look upon them as virtues. Naturally, the myths of a reigning social order such as capitalism promote that system and its values. Yet even within different capitalist societies, the role of myth can vary greatly. Let's expand on this just a bit. For example, the predominant myths in the United States promote individualism, the American dream, and white supremacy. The founding myth is that the American Revolution brought freedom and democracy, yet this revolution in actuality was marked by limited popular involvement, mainly amongst the white and male population, that created the institutions to solidify the rule of a new local ruling class based on expansionism, genocide, and slavery. This legacy of the American Revolution has made it quite easy to be used, obsessively so, I could say, by leaders to promote the dominant values of capitalist society, which is reflected, of course, amongst the working class. The reality of the American Revolution has, in fact, made it difficult to be embraced by those advocating egalitarian change. On the other hand, French society, while also capitalist, has a far more corporatist ethic among the working class than in the United States. modern France owes its origin to the revolution of 1789, which is a massive social upheaval from below that far surpasses what happened in the United States, that brought radical changes that conflicted with its bourgeois leadership at times. While the reigning order in France can be traced to 1789, there's an ambivalence in the embrace of the values of the revolution by the ruling class. Political figures may revere the Republic, but there's no corresponding civil worship of its founding fathers, as can be found in the United States. Although conservatives can wrap themselves in the tricolor, the slogan Liberté, Égalité, Fraternité can easily be appropriated by opponents of capitalism, whether socialists, communists, or anarchists. Mythology, just like ideology, serves the role of initiating and interpolating individuals into subjects. The reigning myths associated with them in society, such as the American Dream or Christian values, are not merely mistaken ideas or examples of false consciousness, but rather they exist in material practices such as schools and churches. According to Louis Althusser, ideology does not exist in the world of ideas conceived of as a spiritual world. Ideology exists in institutions and practices specific to them. We are even tempted to say more precisely, ideology exists in apparatuses and the practices specific to them. Ideology, such as myths, exists through the ideological state apparatuses, or the ISAs, as Althusser calls them. Even though they are private, whether churches, schools, families, they still reinforce the rule of the dominant class through ideology. We can see this in the example of Christian fundamentalism, whose adherents not only believe in God, pray, and attend church. As Althusser says, if he believes in duty, he will have the corresponding attitudes inscribed in ritual practices according to the correct principles. Thus, a Christian fundamentalist is likely to be an American patriot who waves the flag, raises their children to revere the institution and laws of the country, as long as they, of course, those laws are in conformity with family values, and serve in the military, etc. Yet, whereas it was the church that was dominant in feudal society, Althusser identifies the school as the main ISA in modern society. At school, students learn not only skills such as reading, writing, and writing, but socialization and the reigning values and culture of society so that they can eventually become good and obedient citizens. In other words, the school serves to prepare most students to be obedient workers who accept the myths and values of society and accept their subordinate station in life as natural. However, we should not look upon the interpolation of subjects to the ISAs as denying human agency, which is commonly raised against Althusser. The ISAs are necessary not only because it takes more than repressive force for the ruling order to maintain its power, although they of course do that as a final resort, but since class struggle never ceases. Just as the class struggle never ceases, Althusser says, so the dominant class's combat to unify existing ideological elements and forms never ceases. This amounts to saying the dominant ideology can never completely resolve its own contradictions, which are a reflection of the class struggle, although its function is to resolve them. Ideology and myths remain a battleground. For example, the same Christian fundamentalists may consider themselves to be patriotic Americans who believe in free markets, but if they are on strike on a picket line, they will no doubt react with hostility to scabs. Or the fundamentalists may attend a Tea Party rally to protest a more liberal or socialistic government that they see as drifting away from or betraying true American values. Even the non-Marxist Campbell argues that what counts in terms of authority figures such as judges, presidents, or generals is not necessarily who they are individually. It doesn't necessarily matter if the president is adulterer or underhanded, although they shouldn't be. He is still to be saluted and respected because of the role he plays in society. As Campbell says, when we respect the president, it's not the flawed or corrupt individual respect, but you're not responding to them as personalities, you're responding to them in their mythological roles. While the president should not be corrupt, rather he needs to perform that, he needs to understand that to perform the mythological role required of him, that he has to sacrifice his personal desires and even life possibilities to the role that he now signifies. The mythological role of the president is reflected in how the founding fathers, such as Washington, Jefferson, or later presidents, such as Abraham Lincoln, are revered. And we can, of course, see the mythological role played out in presidential campaigns of candidates of whatever party or persuasion, who are portrayed as fighting and standing for America, which can be portrayed with slight variations in meaning. It doesn't matter that all of this is a total fabrication. What matters is the role of the president, regardless of the person, and plays a force of social cohesion and in promoting the myths and ideology of America. Thus, in order for the mythological role of the president to function, it takes interpolated citizens who accept it on the one hand, an individual candidate who can at least appear to, forfeit their own wants and needs for the greater good of the country. The president thus becomes the little embodiment of the nation. The last function of myth that Campbell identifies is its pedagogical role of how to live a human lifetime under any circumstances. Myths can teach you that. For instance, human beings, regardless of the society they live in, go through different stages of life, from childhood to adulthood, with new responsibilities that can include marriage and family. There are different rites and rituals that we are expected to go through and learn how to function as responsible and ethical members of society, which can include graduating from college, going to communion or bar mitzvah. Values taught are naturally colored by class, so that the rituals of the feudal church are different than those of a business school, although perhaps not as much as we may think. Campbell's four functions of myth apply to socialist movements as well, as we shall see later when discussing Mariategui. Even though socialism is founded on materialistic and scientific principles, myths, symbols, and rituals play key roles in teaching militants how to live, fight, and die as comrades for the communist ideal. Now, one of the major influences on Mariategui's Marxism and his understanding of myth came from the work of the French syndicalist theorist Georges Sorel. Mariategui hailed Sorel as an equal of Lenin for understanding the true revision of Marxism in the sense of renovation and the continuation of the work of Marx. Sorel was praised for returning socialism to the original class sentiment of class struggle as a protest against parliamentary pacification and bourgeoisified socialism that was found in reformist socialism. Lastly, Mariategui said Sorel established the religious, mystical, and metaphysical character of socialism, which proved that the strength of revolution is not in their science, it is in their faith, in their passion, in their religious, mystical, spiritual force. Mariategui drew upon Sorel's understanding of myth and his voluntaristic ethos to inform his own creative and non-dogmatic Marxism. However, Sorel remains highly controversial, to put it mildly, and his writings on the power of myth and defense of violence, expressed most clearly in his work, Reflections on Violence, have not only inspired Marxists such as Mariategui and Gramsci, but fascists such as Benito Mussolini. Sorel was originally an engineer by training. He turned to Marxist politics following his early retirement in the 1890s. He contributed to a number of journals and was involved in supporting Alfred Dreyfus, a Jewish officer, falsely accused of treason. However, Sorel did not adhere to the determinism found within the Second International that explained history and the behavior of people through their economic motives. Sorel took up the defense of Marxism against those he perceived as vulgarizers because, to him, the moral content was vital. Sorel was convinced that Marx's theory needed to be renewed and revised, particularly in regards to its understanding of economics, morality, and human action. To that end, Sorel cast an admiring eye on the work of the Italian Marxist Antonio Labriola, and even briefly to the German Edward Bernstein during the revisionist controversy. Labriola was praised for his defense of historical materialism and Marxism as a theory of action. Sorel commended Labriola for breaking with the economic determinism of Marxism and stressing the importance of ethics. As part of Sorel's own revision of Marxism, he came to the conclusion that the labor theory of value no longer has any scientific usefulness and gave rise to a great many understandings. Labriola, of course, never contemplated his own writings being used to declare Marxist economics obsolete, so he broke off relations with Sorel. Sorel's defense of Dreyfus was informed by the moral desire to defend the notions of truth and justice. That same concern would later find its way into Reflections of Violence, written in 1908, and the importance of mobilizing myth. Following the acquittal of Dreyfus, Sorel felt betrayed by the outcome since it only benefited the opportunistic careerist and parliamentary socialism. He was repulsed by the reformist politics of Jean Jaurès and Alexander Millerand, the latter of whom entered a government of Republican defense. Sorel was alarmed by what he perceived to be the statism and Jacobism found in the government and the Socialist Party. He believed that the autonomy of socialism risked being lost in the quicksand of opportunism and the corruption of bourgeois politics. The affair had not raised the revolutionary lane of the proletariat, but smothered it. Sorel believed that any revolution must destroy the institutions and values of liberal democracy that was leading civilization towards decadence. To Sorel, the parliamentarism gradualism found in the parties of the Second International led him to conclude that the anarchists were right about this, and that in entering into bourgeois institutions, revolutionaries have been transformed by adopting the spirit of these institutions. All the parliamentary deputies agree that there is little difference between a representative of the bourgeoisie and that of the proletariat. And his criticism of the dominant orthodoxy of official Marxism was echoed in syndicalist movements that developed in opposition to it, with unions that emerged in France, such as the CGT, the General Confederation of Workers, that eschewed any political action, relied on direct action, and the general strike by workers to bring in the revolution. Following 1906, there was an upsurge of unrest in France that led to strikes amongst postal workers, rail workers, and others. In 1909, the strikes caused the government, led by the ex-Blanquist, Georges Clemenceau, to call the army, who fired upon the workers. By this time, Sorel had embraced syndicalism and attempted to theorize the movement in Reflections on Violence. In this work, he completed his revision of Marxism, expunging any hint of determinism or its use as a method to understand the laws of capitalism. Sorel embraced Henry Bergson's theories of the irrational and the power of intuition, along with Nietzsche's ethics of revolt and the contempt for established morality. For Sorel, Marxism was reduced to the class struggle, and its central tenets were to be interpreted as myths. In contrast to the Gralulists, the hand-lying parliamentary socialists, Sorel praised the syndicalist movement as the great educative force that contemporary society has at its disposal for preparing the work of the future. Central to syndicalism was that it was a reflection of the revolutionary general strike, which produces an entirely epic state of mind that turns the men of today into the free producers of tomorrow, working in workshops where there are no masters. These workers would be transformed through their stealing in the economic epic of modern factories and by participating in the general strike where the proletariat organized itself for battle, separating itself distinctly from the other parts of the nation and regarding itself as the great motive force power of history, all other social consideration being supported to that of combat. It is very clearly conscious of the glory with which will be attached to its historical role and the heroism of its militant struggle. It belongs to the final contest which will give proof to the whole measure of its valor. These heroic workers had no need of a plan for battle or for the conquest of power. Rather, their victory and the downfall of capital would result from the emergence in the working class of a new heroic mentality and the passion of violence which was inspired by the myth of the general strike. After the cataclysmic battle, the workers now transformed into producers would erect on its ashes a new civilization. To Sorel, whereas once the bourgeoisie was still in the great majority, animated by conquering, insatiable and pitless spirit, which at the beginning of the modern epoch had categorized the creators of new industries and the discoverers of new lands, it had now degenerated, become almost as stupid as the nobility of the 18th century. Sorel's argument hinges on the contention that myth encloses the whole of socialism in the general strike, which sees in each strike a model, a test, a preparation for the final battle. Though other Marxist theorists of the general strike, such as Rosa Luxemburg, saw its ethical power in preparing the proletariat for combat, is seen by her as a specific tactic, not a universal theory of revolution. Nor did Rosa Luxemburg ever deny the necessity of Marxist theory for the proletariat, nor did she fetishize violence. For Sorel, there was no way to historically or practically disprove the validity of the general strike because it was a myth that was secure from all refutation. No matter how valid science or criticism could not shake the faith of people in myths such as religion or the general strike. A myth cannot be refuted since it is, as Sorel says, at bottom identical to the convictions of a group, being the expression of these convictions in the language of movement, and it is, in consequence, unanalyzable into parts which can be placed on the plane of historical descriptions. A myth was beyond reason and analysis. Myths like the general strike were important to Sorel because they are almost pure. They allow us to understand the activity, the sentiments, and the ideas of the masses to prepare themselves to enter on a decisive struggle. They're not description of things, but expression of a will to act. Thus, a myth in the modern world is a tool of combat that can inspire people to destroy the existing order. Yet Sorel distinguished myth from a utopia because the latter was an intellectual project which he says is a combination of imaginary institutions, having sufficient analogies to real institutions for the jurist to be able to reason about them. It is a construction which can be broken into parts and of which certain pieces have been shaped in such a way that they can be fitted into future legislation. A utopia can be refuted by showing that it's incompatible with the necessary conditions of modern production. The Sorel detached Marxism from any analysis of society or rationality, or replaced theory with myths that was needed to bring forth apocalyptic violence. Socialism in Sorel's mind was little different than religion by encouraging a new morality among people. And myths could provide this in the way that reason and Marxist materialism could not. The myth of the general strike was an inexhaustible source of regeneration that would serve as a catalyst for new rituals, symbols, and legends and creation to enable the proletariat to affirm and link themselves to something transcendental and eternal. Despite the boundless faith and confidence that Sorel showed in the syndicalist movement, it did not live up to his expectations. Sorel moved away from syndicalism and the proletariat, flirting briefly with the French extreme right before his death in 1922. His passions had been rekindled by both Mussolini, who claimed Sorel as an inspiration, and Lenin. The syndicalist movements in Europe and the United States, despite major strikes, were unable to overthrow the bourgeois state. Neither did syndicalist movements survive the challenge of World War I, with the majority either capitulating to the patriarch sentiments or being suppressed. Syndicalism proved to be utterly deficient in regards to the role of the party and the question of state power. In the end, no general strike anywhere brought down the rule of capital, ultimately proving that syndicalism failed the test of power. It was the Bolshevik Party, organized by revolutionary communists, who were able to revitalize Marxism by leading to successful revolutionary seizure of power and establishing a new order in Russia. Bolshevik success was built on the concept of a revolutionary party, the unity of theory and practice, and the example of Soviets. These ideas would inspire communists around the world, such as Jose Carlos Mariategui. And as we shall see, Mariategui, while holding fast to Marxism as a method and doctrine, will find that Sorel's ideas on myth helped to combat determinism, encourage heroic revolutionary action amongst workers, and ultimately inspire them to create a new socialist world upon a degenerated bourgeois society. Now, Mariategui was actually born on July 14, 1894, which is Bastille Day in Peru, as the sixth child of a humble liberal father and a devout Catholic mother. And his mother primarily raised him. He spent his youth in his grandfather's shop, listening to the stories of laborers who came through and who worked on the lentitudas, whose conditions resembled those of serfdom. At the age of 8, he had an accident where he developed persistent problems in his left leg that eventually caused it to be amputated in 1924, and he was confined in a wheelchair for the remainder of his life. Now, due to his family's poverty, he left school in the 8th grade to find a job to help support them. He managed to acquire employment as a linotypist at age 15 with a Peruvian newspaper. He showed talent in journalism, and he quickly became a writer and then an editor. At the age of 16, he was already showing an interest in socialism. And eventually, he founded two short-lived pro-labor papers. And in 1919, he not only supported the demands of workers and students, but critical of the Peruvian president, who dissolved the Congress and became a dictator. The government closed down the critical papers and exiled Mariategui to Europe as an information agent. And he stayed in Europe until 1923, and the experience actually helped to mature him as a Marxist. He lived primarily in France and Italy, and he encountered a number of socialists and intellectuals such as Gramsci, Benedetto Corsi, Henri Barbusi, among others. While in Italy, he witnessed the Buena Rosa, the two red years of factory occupations that brought Italy to the brink of revolution. He was present at the founding of the Italian Communist Party, and he also met an Italian woman who he married and bore him four sons. By the time he returned home, he was a dedicated and well-rounded citizen. Now, while in Peru, he conducted an amazing array of political work. He lectured to workers at a popular university. He worked with workers, socialists, and trade unions to form the General Confederation of Peruvian Workers and the Peruvian Socialist Party, which would become the Communist Party after his death. He also formed periodicals such as Labor and the journal Amitu, I didn't say that right, or Wise Teacher, to spread left-wing and socialist ideas throughout Peru and Latin America. He also wrote three books during his lifetime, The first, The Contemporary Scene, which is a collection of articles. The second, and more famous actually, is 7 Interpretive Essays on Peruvian Reality, which is an original and creative application of Marxist analysis of Peru, looking at the indigenous and their role in the revolution, along with insights on history, culture, and education. And that work has been hailed across Latin America and the world, and it's influenced Marxists not only such as Che Guevara, but indigenous movements, liberation theologians, among others. And his last published work, which is the more relevant for our purposes, was Defense of Marxism, published after his death, a critique of revisionism and a defense of revolutionary Marxism from a Leninist perspective. And his writing is not objective, but fiercely partisan. Unfortunately, due to declining health, he passed away in April of 1930 at the age of 36. Now, it's in Defense of Marxism that Mariategui sees most clearly sets forth his non-dogmatic and anti-deterministic approach to Marxism and discusses the importance of myths, ethics, and symbols, drawing heavily on Sorel. Unlike Sorel, he stresses the importance of Marxist theory, stating that, now more than ever, the proletariat needs to know what is going on in the world. For him, the only theory that can provide guidance for the proletariat is Marxism. And he says, socialism, beginning with Marx, appears as the conception of a new class, as a theory and movement that has nothing in common with the romanticism of those who reputed the work of capitalism as an abomination. For Mariategui, a Marxist view provided not only clarity on the goal, but served as a guide for revolutionary political action to get there. However, Marxism was not the gradualistic evolutionism found in social democracy, but rather needed to germinate revolutionary consciousness among the workers and spur them to action. As he says, Marxism, where it has shown itself to be revolutionary, that is to say where it has been Marxism, has never obeyed a passive and rigid determinism. Mariategui argued that capitalism would not topple on its own, but it would take conscious effort by the exploited. Otherwise, there was no way out. More than that, Marx's critique remained valid so long as capitalism existed. It was in the continuing struggle to transform the world, whether in the mass actions of the proletariat or the construction of socialism, that Marx's theory was continually renewed. Without the regenerative interaction of theory and practice, Marxism was doomed to wither and die. Yet there are following Sorel, Mariategui argued that it was imperative for the proletariat to make a revolution because bourgeois society was overcome by decadence. This could be seen in its art, literature, and intellectuals. Once the bourgeoisie was a young and heroic and rising class filled with vision and destiny, that had all changed. The modern bourgeoisie was a pale shadow compared to their Jacobin ancestors who overthrew kings and founded republics. Bourgeois society, with its productive power, science, and reason, now covered the world and dissolved the bonds of feudalism and religious faith. After the cataclysm of the First World War and the Russian Revolution, Mariategui drew the conclusion that bourgeois society suffers from a lack of myth, of hope, faith, of hope. Yet in place of these overthrown altars, there was nothing to replace it with. He believed that science and reason were inadequate substitutes for the old myths of religion. Neither science nor reason nor science can meet the need of the infinite that exists in man, he says. Reason itself has been challenged, demonstrating to humanity that it is not enough. Reason and science could only be taken so far. They could not fill the gap in the human psyche in the way myth could. Only myth possesses the precious that virtue satisfying its deepest self. Bourgeois civilization ripped away the holy and the sacred, turning humanity into atomized individuals governed by the faceless market and with its lust for unceasing profit. Bourgeois culture is overwhelmingly permeated by chauvinism, mediocrity, racism, sexism, and selfishness. As the English Marxist Christopher Caldwell would probably put it, this was a dying culture. The end result of this is humanity was reduced to talking tools on an assembly line or as workers to be slaughtered in mass in trench warfare in order to determine which vampires would rule colonial slaves. This is not a society governed by any ideal, but a decadent and diseased one that deserved to die. So what should replace the bourgeois world that was lacking in this? For Mariategui, man is a metaphysical animal. He does not live productively without a metaphysical conception of life. Myth moves man in history. Without myth, the history of humanity has no sense of history. It could only be a new myth that could replace the fallen idols of the bourgeoisie. The new myth That new myth was that of communist revolution. The proletariat actively fights for the myth with a passionate and active faith, he says. In contrast to capitalism, which had nothing to offer, Mariategui claimed that the proletariat affirms. In order for the proletariat to achieve heroic deeds, a transformation is needed in their consciousness. They cannot be satisfied with a bigger piece of the pie or to accept the way the world is. Rather, a revolutionary class does not accept the way the world is. They fight to change it. To that end, workers needed to overcome the individualistic, egotistic spirit, which besides being profoundly antisocial, does not constitute anything but the exacerbation and degeneration of the old bourgeois liberalism. The second thing that must be overcome is the spirit of corporatism, of a trade, of job category, he says. For class consciousness to truly develop and mature, it was imperative for workers to look beyond their immediate horizons and particular trades to see the common position they share with their fellow workers throughout the world. Even more than that, communist consciousness had to embrace Lenin's ideal of the tribune of the people, who's able to react with every manifestation of tyranny and oppression, no matter where it appears, no matter what stratum or class of people it affects. This entails solidarity by revolutionaries in France, Britain, or the United States, with national liberation movements in the colonies, even if they're seen as traitors by their own countrymen. Such treason is loyalty to the revolution and humanity. For the tribune of the people, the struggle for women's rights, anti-racism, or against homophobia are not distractions or divisive, but had to be taken up as part of the common struggle for liberation. Yet class consciousness goes further, doesn't mean just solidarity with the oppressed and exploited, but needs discipline and organization to give it strength and direction. And he says, I want to say to you that it's necessary to give the vanguard proletariat, along with a realistic sense of history, heroic will for creation and implementation. The desire for betterment, the appetite for well-being are not enough. When the proletariat is fired by the vision of a new society, they will know that it won't come down from the skies due to the inexorable development of economic laws, but through organization and active struggle. This struggle entails a vanguard infused with the myth of a new egalitarian society freed of exploitation and oppression. It is that ideal, not the text of Marx's theory or science, that allows revolutionaries to endure prisons, man the barricades, sing songs, and march together against impossible odds. In pursuit of that myth, the word comrade becomes more than a word. Solidarity becomes concrete, and the lyrics of the international are ideals to be achieved. And again, as he says, the strength of revolutionaries is not in their science, it is in their faith, their passion, their will. It is religious, mystical, spiritual force, the force of myth. Ultimately, the proletariat is not struggling for a myth, though, but to create a new and superior civilization. As Mariategui said, we do not wish that socialism America be a tracing and a copy. It must be a heroic creation. This heroism means that the proletariat had to become aware of their historic mission, shake off their subservience to the ruling class, take the destiny of humanity firmly into their hands, and construct socialism. In the class struggle, he says, where all the sublime and heroic elements of its ascent reside, the proletariat must elevate itself to a producer's morality, quite distant and distinct from the slave morality that its gratuitous professors of morals, horrified by its materialism, officially attempt to revive. A new civilization cannot arise from a sad and humiliated world of miserable helots with no greater merits or faculties than their civility and misery. The reformists argue that such a vision is utopian, since the revolutionary overthrow of capitalism will inevitably bring disruption to production, upheavals, and socialism will begin at a lower bourgeois society. Arguably, I would say, Mariategui would accept this, since revolutionaries from all parts of the world must choose between being the victims of violence or using it. It is only natural that a revolution will disrupt things. What else is to be expected? However, there are also heroic echoes found in each revolution, whether those of the ragged Red Army soldiers fending off 14 armies in Russia, the undeniable enthusiasm of constructing new factories during a five-year plan, bringing art to the people, constructing new rituals, culture, and values free of discrimination and subordination. All these deeds may actually take place in ruins, but a new socialist world will rise on its ashes to preserve the interests of redeemed humanity. Mariategui would no doubt have nodded in agreement with the Spanish anarchist Durruti, who expressed his revolutionary optimism as follows. We the workers, we can build others to take their place in better ones. We are building upon ruins, he says. and we can build others to take their place, and better ones. We are not in the least afraid of ruins. We are going to inherit the earth. There is not the slightest doubt about that. The bourgeoisie might blast and ruin its own world before it leaves the stage of history. We carry a new world here in our hearts. That world is growing in this minute. For Mariategui, as opposed to Sorel, myths did not substitute Marxist theory and analysis, but are a necessary supplement to it. While the revolutionary proletariat needed to know the world in order to change it, this was not enough. For the working class to acquire true class consciousness and construct a new order, they needed to be inspired by myths. Myth would raise the proletariat to that higher conception of life and give it the required faith to face the impossible odds and harsh ideals that awaited them. Yet Mariategui argued that the power of revolutionary myths was not just faith in a distant ideal, but enabling the masses to turn the myth of communism into actuality. Now, despite the scientific and secular claims of Marxism, socialism, communism, etc., our movements are not immune from the power of myths, symbols, and rituals. Myths and false consciousness have a material basis for existence that needs to be recognized. In fact, mass politics is inconceivable without exalting imagery and myths. Socialist politics cannot be solely conducted by rationally combating false consciousness in people's heads by explaining the labor theory of value, or the relation between base and superstructure, or selling newspapers, although all of that is no doubt needs to be done. The politics of socialism and communism operates at multiple levels, one being to rationally challenge incorrect ideas, of course, while others involve the symbolic and the mythical. Even in the most secular and rationalistic communist movements, where it is assumed that priests tricked people and manipulated them, elements of the mythical and the symbolic played a great role. To take the example of Blanquist communists in France during the 19th century, who led by the insurrectionist Louis-Auguste Blanqui, who argued that communism can only be achieved by the absolute triumph of enlightenment. One method the Blanquists utilized was printing anti-religious newspapers in order to attack the Catholic Church, which was the spiritual support of the ruling class. Doing so, they believed, would awaken the people. What the Blanquists ultimately believed was needed was for the revolution to triumph was an organized conspiracy led by an enlightened elite, not reliance upon the masses to revolt, which they believed was impossible because they were under the influence of priests and the rulers. Once the coup had succeeded in overthrowing the old order, they would institute an enlightened dictatorship. They would undertake the task of educating people in secular and republican values. Now, even the secular Blanquists were governed by myths, rituals, and symbols. When a member joined the secret society, they took part in an elaborate initiation ceremony where they're blindfolded and had to swear eternal hatred to aristocrats and kings and fight for the republic. Failure to abide by this oath was punishable by death. The Blanquist initiation rites were not invented by them, but copied from other secular movements, such as the Masons and the Carbonari. Initiation into the revolutionary conspiracy was thus nearly a sacred act, like being confirmed in the Catholic Church. And while the Blanquists swore to establish the Republic, even the meaning of that term is actually very vague. Most of the conspirators would be young men. They'd never actually lived under a Republic. The Republic was a myth, an ideal, which had been transmitted to them through word of mouth from older men, from reading history or reading the speeches of Robespierre. The myth of the Republic inspired them to risk their lives to bring the final victory of the revolution. Furthermore, the name of Blanqui was also a symbol and a myth, not just to the conspirators, but to the workers of France. Whatever Blanqui's innumerable and recognized weaknesses in theory and the bankruptcy of his approach, he spent half of his life in jail, enduring torture, and he did not surrender. To millions, he represented resistance to oppression and the communist ideal. And as the current French communist philosopher Alain Badiou argues, well, emancipatory politics is essentially the politics of the anonymous masses. It's through proper names such as Blanqui, and we could substitute Che, Lenin, Mao, Stalin, whoever you want, actually, that the ordinary individual discovers glorious, distinctive individuals at the mediation for his or her own individuality as the proof that he or she can force its infinitude. The anonymous actions of millions of militants, rebels, fighters, unrepresentable as such, is combined and countered as one in the simple, powerful symbol of the proper name. Thus, the rationalist and atheist Blanqui assume the power of both a myth and a symbol. And just like religions, the labor, anarchists, and communist movements have fashioned their own art, symbols, education, and provide a sense of community. take the examples of both the French Communist Party and the German Social Democracy, and whatever other criticism we can say about them, they did not just elect representatives to parliament, but provided an alternative way of life for their members and the wider working class. Social democracy had libraries, sports leagues, choirs, chess clubs for their members and sympathizers. Even if a worker was not a member of either party, they could find a sense of community and reinforcement for their shared values of working class struggle and socialism within the broader subculture that those parties fostered. This helped militants and fellow travelers to develop a shared faith needed to withstand the onslaughts of dominant bourgeois ideology and culture. Party militants and sympathizers may not be able to refute the arguments of bourgeois ideologists, but once they were convinced of socialism and had that belief reinforced by their shared myths, rituals, etc., found within the struggle and culture fostered by the party, their conviction became pretty much unbreakable. In this way, social movements become not a sect, but a shared faith among a community of militants embracing all aspects of life, political, economic, ideological, etc. Movements also develop their own aesthetics and manner of dress. For instance, the Bolshevik Party during the Civil War, where their militants wore leather jackets and combat boots to symbolize their revolutionary zeal. They also embraced the artistic avant-garde, as can be seen in the symbol of Beat the Whites with the red wedge, or the emblem of the hammer and sickle, which continue to be actually powerful representations to convey the values of the revolutionary cause to people. And revolutionary movements also have provided spaces for artists to experiment to translate the values of the movement into symbols, story, images, whether in cartoons, posters, literature, slogans, etc. Yet the aesthetic of each movement is unique and time-specific. For instance, even though they both conveyed a radical aesthetic, the beret and guns of the Black Panthers was far different than the long beards of German radicals in the 1840s. By contrast, to pick on them, sects such as the Spartacus League just replicate images of the distant past and are devoid of life, power, and are inauthentic. At least I hope so. There is a dark side to myths, rituals, and symbolism that, of course, affects our movements as well, just like religions, that needs to be recognized. The French Communist Party was said to be, not without justification, the secular equivalent of the Catholic Church with their own dogma, orthodoxy, heresies, and demons. Trotskyists or Maoist dissidents were cast out of the party, were shunned, ignored, or physically attacked. Militants were encouraged not to question the socialist credentials of the Soviet Union or its many abrupt turns in policy, since this could demoralize workers or cause them to lose faith in the cause. Intellectuals in the party, such as Louis Althusser, would raise their criticisms in deliberately obscure oblique language or keep silent, because otherwise they would be expelled and lose any chance to partake in the great historical mission, which was supposedly embodied by the party. And for communist militants not to be able to work for the cause, that could be a fate worse than death. Now, for example, in the Soviet Union, those who were deemed as showing a lack of faith in the cause, whether by legitimate criticisms or advocating different lines, whether right or wrong, were seen not as a loyal opposition, but as traitors. To cast doubt on the leadership or to question it was to be in league with alien class forces or fascism. Indeed, the great purge trials of the 30s, despite the trappings of legality and jurisprudence, regardless of their lack of physical proof or corroboration, were conducted more like the Catholic Inquisition than a court of law, where heresy was synonymous with treason and unbelief. Ultimately, the only evidence offered for the guilt of the accused was their own confessions. The similarities between Soviet trials and the Inquisition was pointed out by one of the accused, Nikolai Bukharin, who said the confession of the accused is not essential. The confession of the accused is a medieval principle of jurisprudence. Despite the dogmas and inquisitions of myth, and inquisitions that an embrace of myths can encourage in movements, it is impossible to imagine politics without them. There's a material existence to myths that rationalist theories of false consciousness don't recognize. The myths, symbols, and rituals of radicalism remain a part of how we remember our past, imagine our future, forge a common ideal of solidarity so that we know how to live and to die for the communist ideal. Thank you. Okay, before we get started, if you are not signed up for the email list and would like to receive emails, feel free. And believe it or not, programs like this are not sponsored by Shell Oil or other big corporations. We have no corporate sponsors. If you want to put in a few bucks, feel free to put it over. But let's open up for questions. You can respond to me, you can respond to each other, or however you want to do it. I know some people came in late, that's cool. I also wanted to also say that if you missed anything, the full text of this is published on the event page, which is by the magazine Redwich. But yes, you had a question.
Yeah, you know, I know Mariategui was, he's mentioned a lot by the Sendero, and he's himself became sort of a symbol in Peru, particularly with the Sendero. Can you speak to that at all, like his role?
I mean, I'm not an expert on the Sendero, yeah. But what I do know about them, and this is actually very impressive about them, whatever else one can say, is they were probably one of the first groups that, like, organized amongst the indigenous, like, which is the majority population of Peru. Like, during the military dictatorship, the Sendero, or they learned the language, they immersed themselves in the indigenous. So by the time they actually launched the People's War in about 1980, they were already very firmly implanted there, and it was very difficult to remove them. And that approach to the indigenous, I mean, it traces from Mariategui. He was, as far as I know, like the first Marxist, at least in Latin America, who would encourage and approach the indigenous. And this was, of course, be followed by other Marxist groups in, say, Bolivia or wherever else. And that's impressive.
Sorry about my ignorance, but what's the Sendero?
More popularly known as the Shining Path.
Oh, okay.
So they had the People's War that was at its height in like the 80s and early 90s. They're still around in one form or another.
Okay, yeah. I'm looking at the Shining Path than everyone.
Yeah, I mean, they're more popular. That's more an insult to them, but it's Sendero Luminoso, I believe.
Yeah.
And the slogan itself is like taken from Mariategui,
yeah,
actually. It's like Marxism, or it might be actually Marxism, Leninism, the Shining Path, the Revolution. Yeah, so they even take that. But Mariategui, he's like, a lot of these theories, they influence all kinds of people.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just curious.
Yeah. Anything else about myth, revolution? Yes.
I mean, a lot of times, and you mentioned rituals, to a certain extent, I think there's a sense of certain things that radicals do, like May Day, for example, being a kind of ritualistic thing. And a lot of times, I'll compare being a communist in this period to being the last, like one of the last pagans, as when Romans all went Christian. Like, there's a feeling of being like, it's kind of, you know, and to what extent do you think there's a difference between a myth when there's a rising movement versus, you know, now that we're in a very weak period? Is there like a difference, like?
I mean, look at it, like, I mentioned the Spartans, but I could mention other groups as well. It's like they can be very insular and they very much hold on to, like, these old myths, and they become very, like, very dogmatic, insular. Like, whatever else can be said about the Communist Party USA, at its height in the 30s, it was not really an insular movement. It reached out into the broad society.
Reached out.
I'm serious. It's like, you look at the Communist Party USA in the 30s, again, whatever else can be said about the Popular Front and whatnot, this was a movement that was embracing, it was reaching out. A lot of these groups are very convinced of their own, like these very small sects in our period, convinced of their own importance, their title to the vanguard, which is itself almost a mythic idea if you think about it. Depending on your right apostolistic lineage from Marx through Lenin, through maybe through Kautsky, but then you have either Stalin or Trotsky or Mao or whomever. And they, you know, become, you know, you have to, and to become part of some of these groups, they're not encouraging critical thinking. They want you to be able to repeat back the myths to them. And that's like very broad. I'm not picking on a particular group. Like, anarchists do this, Trotskyists do this, other people, you know, Maoists and whomever. Like, this has been common among all these groups. And there are, of course, examples of, more actually among Maoists than, say, Trotskyists, of movements that are not like this. Because most Trotskyist groups are very small. Yes?
Sorel in the early 1900s, also in the early 1900s, Russia after the 1905 revolution, there were segments of the Bolshevik faction that were trying to promote a rethinking of Marxism, and there was a segment that called almost God builders, who thought that Marxism needed to be supplemented with a kind of non-theistic religion that would use many of the symbols and myths of religion, screw up the theism part, and that way they would appeal to the emotional side of the masses. Because they thought that Marxism itself was a little bit too cerebral to really appeal to the workers and peasants.
I know Lenin took issue with
that. Lenin did not like that at all.
But I do know that some of them, would have to be refreshed on the name, but some of them I do believe were involved in the commissar.
First commissar of education.
What?
First commissar of education after the...
Yes, or it's actually, I believe it's called the commissar of enlightenment.
Yeah.
And there will be a court on it. Yes.
They were brothers in law anyways.
I actually didn't know that.
I think they're a drain from pure criticism.
Yeah, that's right.
Extensively. Yeah. Like, kicked out of the party, but Lanishanti, his brother in law, stayed in the party and held official positions later on after the revolution. But by that time, he had officially renounced most of that stuff. But then again, after Lenin died, what did they do with Lenin? Lenin wanted to be buried with his mother.
Yeah.
And instead, his body was in the mummified on display as if like a sacred element, like a sacred relic.
And it's like
so some of that thinking.
It's like, yeah, if you want to actually example like a sacred, like an interpretation of that, read Stalin's funeral oration to Lenin. It's like literally like we swear to thee, comrade Lenin. It's like it's got very religious overtones like that. It's like very odd, you know, in the like how that's worded.
In various times in Soviet history, at various times, people did try to explicitly try to promote secular forms of ritual in order to take the place of religion.
Yeah, I mean, I was actually thinking of some of my family had a personal story. They took German exchange students in like the early 90s, and a lot of them are actually from East Germany, and they would. You know, my family members who are doing this were actually like Seventh-day Adventists and everything. And this did not go over well with some of them because like, they were not religious at all. They were actually, you know, they were, at the very least, they're very secular. Because they had gone through like all like these rituals in East Germany, which had promoted like a very secularistic culture, rationalistic. And it's like, which was interesting, because it's like, no, I went through this in Germany. I forget the name of the ritual they mentioned.
Like
but it's something that confirmed that they were an adult. I don't know what it's called.
GDI had like a confirmation ceremony.
Yeah, it was something like that.
Because the Lutherans and the Catholics had that.
Yeah.
And they wanted a secular version of that that would be able to compete with what the churches were doing. And in fact, that was very popular. And even after the GDI disappeared a few years afterwards, humanist groups revived it.
Right, and I believe even to this day, like a lot of like these Eastern European countries have seen like revivals of religion. I mean, in some cases it may not have actually been like gone away actually, but like East Germany is like also like the Czech Republic is a very high proportion of non-religious people in there. But it's like you're talking about rituals. Like a good example of like new rituals emerging is these two books on China that are very good. One is called Fan Xin, if you have read it. The other is called Xin Fan, which is about the Chinese Revolution in Fan Xin, like its beginning, like in the land reform movement in the 1940s. And then Xin Fan is about, you know, continuing that through the 70s. And it's very interesting. Like they can pass a new law that women are equal. But how does that actually play out on the ground? And you get to see in these two books how that works. It's like, oh, landlords are dispossessed, but it's like, what does that mean? Do they have no land that they can work on? Are they just left to die? Do they have a little plot? And these villagers, you know, along with the communist activists there, they have to deal with this. And it's really, like, probably just an incredible account of this, because you not only see like it initially happening, like the revolutionary explosion in like 1949, they continue this for decades. And how do they sustain this? How do they build these new rituals, these new symbols? How do they live as free citizens? Because it's like, I know I've mentioned this particular thing before, but it's like, before 1949, these were not considered people. These were peasants. These were human garbage. You could be sold into slavery. You could die. No one cares. Now suddenly, you're not. You're an equal citizen with everybody else. There's no emperor. There's no Chiang Kai-shek or whatever. Women can get divorced without issue. And it's like, that becomes a lived practice for these people. Yes, the law is on the books, but how does that translate looking down? And of course, the Soviet Union did stuff like this. Revolutionary France did this. And Reconstruction of the United States is another good example. Slaves are now citizens. What does that mean? It's like, we can talk about the laws and the legal questions and the judicial aspects of it, but how does it work on a day-to-day, on a mythical level? What is that ideal that you're trying to be? It's very interesting to look at. I know I'm kind of rambling, but someone else, feel free to ask questions.
Yeah, I was thinking about when you were talking about the creation of, a new body of symbols and things like that, I was thinking of when the Jacobins were ruling and the Temple of Reason and all that stuff, the attempt to create that, it seems like that is a feature of sort of a certain type of revolutionary construction, where the sense is that you're starting with a blank slate and now everything's new. And so we've got to figure out in this new society what we're going to carry forward, or what's going to take the place of the things that we're getting rid of. And you see that, with the Jacobins, up through the Soviets, Chinese, so on and so on.
Yeah. I mean, in the Jacobin case, they literally started the calendar.
That's amazing.
So it's like, we're in year 220 something now.
Year one. There is no more powerful sort of symbol.
I mean, one thing is the apparently when they wanted to do the trials, they also tried to do the week, I think, of Jacobin. What I was interested in was the IWW had a lot of this stuff, but it was almost explicitly against. It was more explicit because they had the issue, a lot of the songs were created to counter the Salvation Army, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of, that's almost an explicit attempt to combat religion by creating a more revolutionary myth, which is interesting, I guess. I mean,
in a sense, like, I've heard, the IWW, a legit mass movement in its height, tens, hundreds of thousands of people pass through it. It's like you would ride the rails. It was like, the mythology of the hobo riding the rails, the free speech fights. They had a mythological function. Even the Spanish anarchists who were even larger than the IWW, like some of like the way I read, like how they describe some of these early anarchists, it's like almost like preachers going around, even on their own literature. It's kind of interesting.
I feel like a lot of it was like, but both of those movements had issues directly in conflict with religions, especially in Spain. You had the, the Spanish followed their priest either with a candle or a club, and if it was a cloak. And they were almost like explicitly trying to counter, they're creating an alternative to the church, which is interesting, I guess, with their own beliefs. And with the hit, I think it's what about like music is an important part of religion, obviously. How does like the hymn stuff is in? I feel like there's a lot of secular, obviously international, but also all these songs are an important part of that. I think when you're singing collectively, there's a feeling. The same thing when you're in church, the singing of hymns together is an experience. It's one of the most profound, more religious experiences. And I think is there an element of that with specifically hymns or revolutionary songs?
Oh, I would. Yeah. I mean, look at. We can go down the list. You mentioned the international. That's a great example. The Marseillaise, the battle hymn of the Republic, or Solidarity Forever. I mean, it's really an uplifting experience, like, to be able to sing some of these in, like, it's one thing to hear people sing it, but to partake in a singing of Solidarity Forever at a demonstration or something, that's pretty intense, actually. And it's like, sometimes, like, doing that, like, with, like, a huge group of people, it's like, you may be, like, the demonstration could even take, like, a further militant step. Like, I've been in demonstrations, like, I'm not gonna do X, Y, and Z, and I end up, because I'm with a large group of people singing songs, I'm gonna do X, Y, and Z now. Yeah. It's like, it just happens, because you're in that moment. Anything else? Probably could have referred to Gramsci in this, but I'd already done a lecture.
I mean, like, taking this slightly different way, how do movements try to, can movements also incorporate, like, one thing I'm thinking of recently is there's been a lot of, I went to a talk recently, a little bit ago about the Hunger Games, and how, it's a very, like, in terms of actual politics, very, you know, close, but how a lot of times that imagery has been incorporated into movements. How does, to what extent is it, like, when people in, when you can incorporate things from the current society into taking a different form. But I know Hunger Games, there was like, I think it was a reference in someone put a Hunger Games quote somewhere, like spray painted it on something.
Sure.
Like, I mean, I guess it's like, I feel like it's a lot of times people will do that, they'll incorporate the.
Yeah, they'll find subversive elements and all kinds of stuff. Like, let's go to the 60s. One of the most, I don't think you like the politics, but the Weathermen is from a Bob Dylan song. You don't need a weatherman to. And of course, within, you know, 60s radicals like Gandalf for president and stuff from Lord of the Rings. You actually still see that, and that would be a better choice than whom we have in running, but that's a whole other issue we could talk about. But the point is, the Hunger Games, people will use the imagery or whatever. Because it's like, it's got a radical subversive element to it and people incorporate it. Or if it doesn't, people just incorporate it anyway.
Just invent it.
I mean, it's like, you really can't actually predict in some ways what the aesthetic can be. Like, Occupy had its own particular aesthetic. The anti-globalization stuff like 10 years earlier had its own aesthetic. I can't tell you what aesthetic's gonna be what, but it's like, you can tell. It's like, you know, the aesthetic, like the hammer and sickle, still means communism. You can draw that pretty easily and, you know, show people. Or you can do like the 99%, you know, at least a few years ago.
You can still do that.
Yeah, you can still do that, and people know what you're talking about. You're conveying, like, in a sense, like a simple and a complex idea in a very simple, like,
yeah,
a recognizable form. But we do incorporate all kinds of stuff from popular culture because we're part of it. Unless you're one of these bizarre sects in the middle of nowhere, you know, totally insular. But then, of course, you're not going to ever be this. It's like a good example from a religious perspective is the Catholic Church would incorporate, to make their adoption easier by the population, all like these pagan gods and saints.
Yeah, my mom is a Catholic, well, at least for lack, is kind of very, is very, I think she calls herself an atheist Catholic. But she finds,
too, it's okay.
She finds there's right now at the Catholic Church is a department tasked with finding all the saints that are really just pagan gods. And she says that she really finds that very annoying. She does not like that. I kinda like that. I like all the saint. I grew up kind of like, I'd say I'm culturally Catholic. So I like a lot of the Catholic, like,
sure,
mythology is kind of fun.
Like, a lot of the people, like, who Sorel was hanging around on the French far right, a lot of them were actually atheists, but they wanted to be in the church. They wanted to experience its rituals and power and everything. And they also saw the church as providing that kind of function of social cohesion.
The founder of the Action Force.
Yeah.
His doctrines were excommunicated for being, or condemned.
He wasn't an atheist. His doctrines were condemned as being atheistic by the church.
Well, they had the American philosopher, Georges Sorel. trying to let some of his friends know that they heard any rumors out on ethnic conversions to discount them because those would be false. But he didn't mind hanging around with a Catholic order, even though he was an atheist.
And something else, sometimes you see this in different national struggles, is like, as like some of these parties, both socialists, communists, and whatever, they'll always look for predecessors, sometimes legitimately or not, like to their tradition. So the French communists could draw upon, say, the revolution, like bourgeois figures. And the US party, in, I think wrongly, would communism is 20th century Americanism. I don't like it either, but I'm saying like they're trying to draw upon this. Again, I don't like it, but I'm saying like they do this.
They always would have images of George Washington and Abraham Lincoln
and Earl Brown or something.
Yeah, and Earl Brown. It's like a used car salesman. Just like Max Schachter, by the way. And that's not far from the truth. but you see that, and part of the revolution, when I talk about Benjamin in February, it's like you reverse these verdicts of history. So in Tsarist Russia, the Decembrists, the populists, all these other socialists and anarchists were rebels and traitors. They were condemned. The revolution happens, you're building statues to these people, you're teaching them rules, you're honoring them. Those verdicts change. Like, at one point, the Soviet, which didn't last long, but they just made a statue to Robespierre. They're honoring not just their own national predecessors, but internationally, like...
They honored, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, they had a battleship called the Murat.
Right. And here's a good contemporary example. In the wake of the Charleston shooting, there's been a lot of anger and, like, spray-painting of Confederate memorials. Because... And people say it's just a monument. Well, the monument, it's not just a monument. It's white supremacy, it's slavery, it's all of this. And people, they want to reverse that verdict because that's been, of course, accepted in the United States since its founding and was even at a hyper level with the Confederacy. But it's like in defacing them, it's trying to change the verdicts of history. It's trying to challenge this narrative.
Speaking of that, when the revolution happens, knock on, is there any wood around here?
The what?
It's a knock on wood, is it like, that's your ritual, you can like, look, I was like, when the revolution happens, knock on wood, kind of, you know.
Yeah.
Well, what do you do? I think it would be actually better to like, just leave them up, but like, just face them, it would probably be a better strategy than just tearing them down.
Yeah, I mean, obviously some stuff you're gonna leave up, like the Bolsheviks did not destroy the Bolshoi or the Kremlin, they're still there. They destroyed some things, but there is a sense of like this break in history with a revolution, and you have to create a new myth, a new symbols.
I think that like what I would say is with these statues, I think keeping them up and defacing them would actually be, because they are a part of history. You are
a
history, but I think that like people say, oh, we just want to just tear them down. It's kind of a bit too simplistic to deny it that it happened. But you said reversing the verdict of history would be, you know, I think it'd be more fitting to like. Either some of them you tear down, but you also like deface them. Actually, kind of like a better way of relating to these historical monuments is allowing them to be like defaced.
Sure. Like the French Babouvists, who were the communists in the French Revolution, they planned when they took power. It's never happened, but they planned to burn and torch like the mansions of the rich and just leave them up forever as monuments to their cruelty and oppression.
Napoleon.
They blew up this because it's like it's a symbol of militarism and oppression.
And certainly things like a statue of Nathan Bedford.
Oh yeah,
like that shit's got to go.
Oh yeah,
like, you know, whatever Jefferson can stay, like Confederate generals and Jefferson Davis and people like that. I mean, that's, you know, it's like having a statue of Himmler in Germany. Like, boy, he's a great historical figure.
Right.
Yeah. No.
I was imagining of rituals, you'd have like an annual thing where you'd go for everyone, like you could get like a parade to like some statue and just spray paint it like every year as like a ritual.
Why not?
It's like...
It's like these rituals develop, like the dancing of the Liberty Pole, you know?
What's that?
Yeah, know, that used to be done on May Day and stuff. Or, no, that was in the French Revolution, I'm sorry. Getting mixed up here. But it's like, you come up with this new stuff, and again, we're not... We may have ideas, but what's going to actually form, I don't know.
What about, like, recent stuff? Is there any, like, can you... I don't know, have you seen anything, like, when you, like, any stuff, I don't know, I've not been involved very much because I'm young and there's much going on in my area, but has there been anything, like, rituals developing almost, like, Occupy had a lot of rituals, so Karen was a better ritual.
Yes, they did have.
But, well, they're, like, I think a lot of union stuff has that, too.
Yeah.
Unions will have... Whatever Guy Fawkes is actual, you know, religious, like, was Catholic authoritarian or whatever. What was he? He was Catholic.
He wanted to blow up Parliament and everything because, you know, he wanted to bring back, like, the Catholic Church. I mean, it's like... And, of course, he's been morphed through popular culture, through myth, into this anti-establishment, almost semi-anarchist figure.
He's like...
And that really bad movie that's not faithful to the comic book, V for Vendetta, helped too.
Wasn't that about, like, George Bush? Like, the movie was about George
Leaving that, I mean, we can get into V for Vendetta. It's not even faithful to the comic book, which is my bet. But it's like, that's part of the myth. I mean, yeah. You can point that out to people. Point out to an anarchist about some of, like, the more unsavory stuff about Spain or Macno. Point out to Trotsky some of the stuff about their guy and their movements. A lot of people, if they're really immersed in that, they don't want to hear it.
Yeah, I mean, it's one thing if it's like, I think if Guy Fawkes is one thing, it's not really about Guy Fawkes, it's about the symbol. That's one thing, it doesn't really matter. Whatever you... But at the same time, I think, like, Lenin or, like, a lot of, like, it's one thing if it's, like, Guy Fawkes masks. It doesn't really matter what Guy Fawkes is. But if it's an actual historical figure, where it's, I think, more important to, like, to understand the faults, because...
Oh, yeah, no, I mean, I'll give you an example. Like, when I became political, I became a Trotskyist. And although I still have a lot of respect for that, I didn't understand the faults. I couldn't. I had this very mythological and symbolic view of this. And that's not something I would actually encourage in people, because it actually inhibits creative thinking. It encourages a critical analysis. And you really, whether you're one to Trotskyist, a Maoist, or whatever, what have you, you really should actually look at their faults and looking at the real, quote-unquote, the real figure, whoever it is.
Yeah. Mythology.
But it's like, what I'm trying to say, I mean, the whole point of the talk is saying, like, this stuff functions, whether one wants to acknowledge it or not.
Yeah, it's important. Yeah, to acknowledge. I think that...
And you can see that among, like, people who are caught... You can point up the, like, in a vibrant communist movement and wherever, and you point out, oh, look at the gulag or this. It's like, you know, people, they've already been in this mythological structure.
It's like...
That they can deal with that.
So it
doesn't affect them.
It's almost like pointing out it's like pointing out all the evidence for creation.
I mean, Gramsci once said, like, you know, there are people, in, you know, like, faithful man of the people, you can explain to them logically why they're wrong. You can debunk them totally, but they're gonna go to a priest and to say, I know you, I think you're right, but I'm gonna go to this priest and he's gonna tell me why you're wrong. So it's like, and that's like that with all kinds of movements. Because they, again, this stuff has a material existence, why it exists. Like, point out the flaws of Bernie Sanders to Sanders supporters. Some of them may acknowledge you, but it's like, well, but I don't want to get into a Bernie bashing thing here. But it's like, again, it has a mythological function even there.
Yeah, much less.
But it exists, that's the point. And you can see, again, even with Donald Trump, a lot of these figures, they develop these
probably mythologies. Donald Trump more than Sanders.
It exists among both, and whoever has more, but...
That picture of that baby.
Yeah, but that woman who was doing that, thank Jesus for President Trump, she's got a whole mythology of what he represents, of what he's going to do. It may bear, actually, in her case, it might be a frightening reality of what he would do, but it does have a mythological function. Anyone else got points, comments, suggestions, polemics? Facebook polemics. Tired. My ears and stuff. Again, if you missed the talk, it's already published. The video will hopefully be up by tomorrow. And if there's nothing else, next month is Nikos Polans. It's at least part of his work. And that talk's already published. So thank you all for coming. And feel free to donate money.
I want to donate. If I donate to the bank, I'll withdraw some money.
Yeah, I know.